I don't know how many of y'all look at the Bible. My wife brought up a picture this morning. And it made me think a little bit, but how many of y'all ever looked at the back of your Bible and you see the timeline up there? You ever kind of wonder, like I do, like, I wonder if this person knew this person. I wonder how long these people live. How did they get that information? How did the next person learn what the rules were, what they were supposed to be doing? God has kept His word going throughout the ages, and His pure word is His holy word that inspires us every day. And that's kind of the point of my sermon this morning. And I've entitled it "Faith on Fire, Part 2." Have any of y'all paid attention to the news lately about the humanitarian crisis going around in the world? Have y'all been following the people that are coming up from Honduras to avoid the poverty and the wars and the violence that's going on there? How about the Syrian refugee crisis back in 2017? How about the ISIS epidemic? This is going to be my first attempt at using a PowerPoint slideshow, so please bear with me. If any of you are familiar with ISIS, they have a very, I would say, bloody taste for violence. Recently, in the past little bit, this group captured villages in northern Iraq that were home to many Christians who were forced to either convert to Islam, run, or be executed. ISIS basically seeks to purify Iraq and its neighboring countries from non-Islamist influences. Their brutal methods are too graphic to describe here, but they include the murdering of unbelievers by beheading them, including children as well. And as a mockery of Christ, they've even executed some by crucifixion. Their relentless savagery has gained worldwide attention from world leaders who have called this a genocide. Even world leaders like the Pope have called that the world must step in to stop this violence and the suffering of Christians. Humanitarian airdrops were made to help religious minority groups in northern Iraq who desperately needed basic food and water. The terrorist barbaric actions had driven them into the mountains where 50,000 of them, in our region alone, were starving, and again, many of these were children. What about today? I came across an article on the internet when I read my email. Google provides a lot of information for you. But I came across an article dated November 2nd, 2018, out of New Delhi, and this was from the Morning Star News. It was titled, "Three Acts of Aggression Against Christians in Assam State, India, in 1 month have raised concerns among Christian leaders." The final article was aggression against Christians. And the story says, Brahma and his family, who became Christians 2 years ago, saw their house was surrounded as villagers demanded that he return to his prior religion or leave the area. Video footage shows the Hindu priest warning the Christians. Okay. They were warning the Christians to either leave, might be or face the consequences. A local pastor commenting on the video said, "They say in the video that they're going to come again. And if the government does not take action of eliminating the district of Christians, we will do it ourselves. Those who become Christians will be thrown out of the village, and all those who are already Christians will be thrown out as well. They will also be physically assaulted." The pastor says again, that all the villagers usually give their offerings in the form of bread, if they're farmers, or whatever form they can to the priests of the Hindu temple. He said, once the villagers become Christians, though, they stop giving their offerings to the temple, and this is making the Hindu priests very angry because they lose their revenue. I know we've heard it all, but this is an amazing fact how money can not only affect politics, they can affect religion as well. The villagers continued to threaten Brahman and his family, demanding that they leave the area if they did not comply with the demand of one village, one faith. And on that note, I'd like to have an opening word of prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, thank you for the opportunity to be up here this morning, Lord. You have given us your word, Lord, that has stood the test of time, Lord. There have been people that have tried to stamp out your word, Lord, and to put us under the fingernail of state control. But Lord, we know that your word is true. We know that we have a God that will prevail, and we know what the end result is, Lord. So we thank you for that. Thank you for your status and everyone that is here. Please bless these words that come out of my mouth, Lord, that it would lift you, your name up. In Jesus' name, amen. The reason I felt so impressed to speak on this subject was not about the doom and gloom that we hear in the news today, but to prove that the Bible was still as true today as it was 2,000 years ago. And this morning, or actually this week, I was studying the text of Christ, and there was a chapter about studying the Bible in there, and it kept home with me. When I read a quote here, it says, "The mind will be enlarged if it is employed in tracing out the relationship of the subjects of the Bible, comparing scripture with scripture, and spiritual things with spiritual." Another example that also hit home for me was the example they refer to as the miner. And it says that he was repaid by diligent searching, who discovers the veins of precious metal concealed beneath the surface of the earth. And so it is for those who persevere by searching the Word of God for his true treasures, who will find truths of great value which are concealed from the views of the careless seeker. How many of you get up in the morning and have your devotional and have to read the same line over and over again before it finally makes sense to you? And I know I'm guilty of that. And so the focus of my story today, and hopefully from my next sermon as well, will be about the benefit of hiding these valuable truths in our hearts and minds, and how the habits of these Christians many years ago allowed the Word of God to be unmistakably imprinted in the minds of the adults and their children alike, giving them the opportunity to spread the good news to many others who were willing to hear. They had a clear understanding and unwavering faith in the validity and the truth described in God's Word, not the rituals and indulgences that were spread by the mainstream at that time. And another question I have, how many of y'all come to Sabbath school or church every day and you learn something new that maybe you haven't heard before? As my family knows, I have a little bit of a history buff. And for me, reading the Bible and comparing it to other texts and historical events makes it come alive to me. And so that's the way my sermon is outlined today, to give you a little bit of history of how God's Word was maintained throughout the years. If you look at the screen up here, there's three guys up here, and I don't know if any of y'all have heard the stories of Wycliffe, Huss, and Jerome, who were martyred for their faith well over 500 years ago. But very controversial statement that in every age, there were witnesses for God, men who cherished their faith in Christ as the only mediator between God and man, who held the Bible as the only rule of life, and who hallowed the two Sabbaths. These men were branded as heretics, their motives impugned, their characters questioned, yet despite all this, they stood firm for God. Most of my message today comes from the Great Controversy, Chapter 4. And in my previous sermon, I first saw how God revealed the Bible from Stephen to the Apostle, stood firm in their faith for God and His words, despite the hardship and the persecution that they endured by the Jews themselves and the Roman Empire. And today, I would like to move forward from there and see how God's Word continued to survive throughout the years, and how the Bible backs up these details in various verses that we're going to discuss. The time period I'm going to talk about, this deals with the 1260-year period of papal oppression, foretold in the prophecies of Daniel chapter 7 and also Revelation chapter 13. The Great Controversy, page 54, states that Christians were forced to choose whether to yield their integrity and accept papal ceremonies and worship, or wear away their lives in the dungeon, or suffer death by the wrath, the axe, etc. And there's a story in the Bible, and I know the kids are probably familiar with this, about the same thing that happened back in Daniel's time, where Daniel and his three friends suffered in the fiery furnace. In Daniel chapter 3, verse 14 to 30 says, "Is it true that you do not serve my God nor worship the golden image that I have set up?" This is the same thing that happened in the Middle Ages period as well. And if you can, turn with me to Revelation 12, verse 6. And I would like to read that with you. Revelation 12, verse 6. Then the woman fled into the wilderness, where she had a place prepared by God, the day she knew her there were 1,260 days. During this period of time, the Roman Church exercised her increasing power. Thus beginning the period of the Dark Ages. During this time, it seemed that the true religion would be banished from the face of the earth. But if you read your Bible, you know that God is in control. He didn't turn a blind eye. He heard the prayers of the saints, just like he heard the prayers of the Israelites when they were in bondage, the bondage of Pharaoh in Egypt. Just like the words we read, that Junior read this morning in Psalms 12, verse 6 and 7, it says, "The words of the Lord are pure words, like the silver tried in the furnace of earth, purified seven times. You shall keep them, O Lord. You shall preserve them from this generation forever." So God did preserve His word. And people during this period of time were taught not only to look at the Pope as their mediator, but to trust the works of their own to atone for their own sins. They developed long pilgrimages, acts of penance, the worship of relics, creations of shrines and altars, and the payment of large sums of money that were done to appease the wrath of God and secure His favor. And I want to give you a little history of this time period as well, just for a reference, because if you listen, you will determine that this still applies to the church today. Image worship became more general, candles were burned to the images, and prayers were offered to saints, and these images to the saints were everywhere. This reminds me a little bit of the story of the Ark of the Philistines that we read about the other day in Sunday school. How the Philistines took the Ark from the Israelites, and they set it in their temple, Dagon, who was the primary god of the Philistines at that time. And if you remember a little bit about the story, this worship had been going on. The Philistines started getting sick. So they made images with golden rats and golden humors and returned them to the Israelites for taking the ark as a trespass offering for offending God. So the same God that they had there, the God of Dagon, if you look at the post tax, and this is just kind of interesting to me, but it looks like the same thing. And if you look up pictures on the internet, you can see pictures just like this of Dagon on the left hand side and the Pope on the right hand side, and they kind of look very similar. Rome at this time was also engaged in sun worship. If you take the obelisk that stands in front of St. George's Peter's Basilica in Rome, I didn't know about this before we went to Europe a few years ago. But the Egyptians were also known for sun worship and demonstrated their homage to the sun in several ways. Heliopolis in Egypt was the center of worship, sun worship, and this Heliopolis was at the center of the city. This is the same one that's currently standing in St. Peter's Square And it was ordered there in AD 3741 by the Emperor Caligula to be transported from Heliopolis to Rome, and it was moved to its current site in 1585. The Egyptians also worshipped the sun in other ways. They also worshipped the sun god. And if you look at one of the objects that the Pope holds, this is an exact image of that god that they worship. Another example is the rosary. And if you look at Matthew 6, verse 7, I put that on the screen there for you to read it. Don't have to look it up here in my Bible. I'm going to read it for you. But the rosary is fundamental in the worship of Mary for all Catholics. And again, I find it interesting how the Bible addresses this entire time together. Matthew 6, verse 7 says, "And when you pray, do not expect reputations as the heathen do, for they think they will be heard for their many words." And also, St. Peter, St. Mary, and St. James were also introduced so people could imitate their good behaviors and try to live life like them, which is not necessarily a bad thing. But Christianizing pagan things that were already there, like the modern baby, which is the Queen of Heaven, made it easier for pagans to become believers. All of these things are real life things that they can touch and see and buy. They make replicas of, but all this does is eliminate our faith in a God that we are not able to see, that we can't touch. But do we do the same thing today, try to make it easier for people to come into our churches and get members instead of preaching the Word? I heard a story just last weekend. Some friends came to visit us from Arizona, and they told me about a story they went to visit us in the Phoenix, Arizona area. They went to a girl that they were familiar with, was getting baptized in a non-denominational church. So they went to see her, and they sat down in the congregation. And after a little while, the lights still started, the fog started coming, the baptism was kind of encouraging rush through. The husband got up and went out into the hallway outside the church. He noticed a few things that were just a little bit different, and he talked to them, and he said, "This is something that the congregation members like." But all the members were sitting out in the hallway, or at least most of the males were. There was an area set up with a bunch of tables with the TVs on the wall, with the Sunday football game going. Most of the guys were out in the audience watching the football game. There was a Starbucks there. There was food and basically some veteran stands going on. And they said, "This is what is attracting the people to come to this church." So do we? I've never seen this manifest at all, but we kind of sometimes do the same thing in the way that we approach our church service as well. So, it's just been imperative of God and worship to be to Him just by talking to a friend. He doesn't want you to hear the same thing over and over and see the same behavior over and over. Nor would you. Now, I want you to know that I'm not picking on God's people who are Catholics. I'm basically just picking on the system as a whole. I just think the system is an example of the leader controlling the power of the state. And I plan to show you how this is done in a little bit more detail in my next sermon. But I do have a couple of examples in the Bible in the meantime. And if you look up at the screen here, if you turn to me or you can read it on the screen, it says 1 Kings 16. Verses 25 to 33. And I'm going to basically read that real quick here. 1 Kings 16:29-33. Okay, this is the story of Ahab. It says, "In the 38th year of Asa, king of Judah, Ahab the son of Omri became king over Israel. And Ahab the son of Omri reigned over Israel in Samaria 22 years. Now Ahab, the son of Omri, did evil in the sight of the Lord more than all who were before him. And it came to pass, as though it had been a trivial thing for him to walk in the steps of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, he took with his wife Jezebel, the daughter of Jezebel, king of the Sidonians, And he went and served Baal and worshipped him. Then he set up an altar for Baal in the temple of Baal, which he had built in Samaria. And Ahab made a wooden image. Ahab did more to provoke the Lord God of Israel to anger than all the kings of Israel who were before him. And if you turn back to just a little bit to 1 Kings 21, verse 25, that one verse 2 says, but there was no one like Ahab who sold himself to do wickedness in the sight of the Lord, because Jezebel, his wife, stirred him up. During this time, believers hid in caves in groups of 50. Elijah, the prophet at this time, was afraid he was the only one left. And he prayed out to God, and God said, no. He gave him an answer. He said, 1 Kings 19, verse 18, he said, yet I have reserved 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him. We may think we're the only ones left, but we're not. God has preserved his word and will preserve his people. The time I'm talking about here, working up to, began in the 13th century and was called, according to the Great Controversy, the most terrible of all the instances of the papacy, called the Inquisition. Great Controversy, page 59, states that the Prince of Darkness wrought with the leaders of papal hierarchy. In their secret council, Satan and his angels controlled the minds of evil men, while unseen in the midst of an angel of God. Taking the fearful record of their inquisitive decrees and writing the history of these deeds too horrible to appear to human eyes. Another verse here is in Revelation chapter 6, 17, verses 4 through 6. I'm going to open up, and you can open up with me if you'd like to. Revelation 17, verses 4 through 6. The woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet, and adorned with gold and precious stones, having in her hand a golden cup full of abominations and the filthiness of her fornication. And on her forehead a name was written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and of the abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I marveled with a great amazement. This symbol for this woman is the apostate church. And during this period of time, J.A. Wiley says, the noon of the papacy was the midnight of the world. The Holy Scriptures were almost completely unknown, not only to the people, but to the priests as well. Just like the Pharisees, the papal leaders also hated the words of God, which would spread light on their sins. Have you ever tried to look at the stars at night, especially with a full moon? Sometimes it's a little bit hard to see the stars, but what about when there's total darkness, when you can't see much at all, except the stars shining bright? God has set up people through the ages just as a light like this, just like the early church in the Bible, all the way to the Laodicean people who carried out the sacred words of the Bible. The names of these people that stood back in their beliefs in the Word of God, in the dark ages of papal supremacy, who believed the words of God, thus saith the Lord, are written in heaven. But you will find little place of honor or place of human records of these people. This will be the same with all who regard the Bible as truth today. Rome's goal was to get rid of any discovered heresy and destroy the records of cruelty over this treatment of sinners. You may be regarded as not cool, a stickler to the rule, too conservative, too liberal, not following mainstream beliefs, or even heretical, but don't worry. If your name is written in the Book of Life, it is not a consequence what men write about you here on earth. We know what we have to look forward to. We have a responsibility, like these people, to keep the Word of God, alive and well. I'd like to also invite you to the introduction to the Bible for the chapter of Jude. And the introduction to this chapter says, fight, contend, do battle. When apostasy rises, when false teachers emerge, when the truth of God is attacked, it is time to fight for the faith. In Jude chapter 3, or verse 3, it says, beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. Great controversy, page 64, says, the church in the wilderness, in massive trial and hierarchy, is thrown in the world's great capital, was the true church of God, the guardian of the treasures of truth which God has committed to his people to be given to the world. During this period of time, if you did not believe in transubstantiation, where the bread actually becomes the body of Christ, that belief alone was enough to cause you to be branded as a heretic. Thus, it is the Waldenses, who were the first people of all Europe to obtain a translation of the Holy Scriptures in their native tongue. They stood up to the Church of Rome to resist her corruption despite long-continued persecution. Throughout the Dark Ages, there were Waldenses who denied the supremacy of Rome, who rejected image worship as idolatry, and who kept the true status. But sadly, with this resistance, along came other people who stood ready for the sacred gate to betray the innocent. If you can turn with me to Matthew 26, verse 14 to 16. Matthew 26, 14 to 16 talks about Judas, and it says, then one of the 12 called Judas Iscariot went to the chief priests and said, what are you willing to give me if I deliver him to you? And they counted out to him 30 pieces of silver. So, from that time, he sought opportunity to betray him. So, this behavior is nothing new. It's been going on. The Church of Rome was willing to pay anything to destroy these heretics that did not doubt their supremacy. Also, the Mount of Blessings, page 32 and 33 says, in every age, God's chosen messengers have been reviled, persecuted. Yet through their affliction, the knowledge of God has been spread abroad. The minds of the people must be agitated. Every controversy, every reproach, every effort to restrict liberty of conscience is God's means of waking me up, minds that otherwise might slumber. The next verse I've got is Hebrews 11, verse 36 to 40. I'll read that real quick here. Hebrews 11, 36 to 40. But still others had trial of mockings and scourgings, yet in their chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn in two, were tempted, were slain with a sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, and whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains, in dens and caves of the earth. And all these, having obtained a good testimony through faith, did not receive the promise. God, having provided something better for us, that they should not be made perfect apart from us. So verse 39 says they did not receive the promise. But if you turn back one page with me to you, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 13. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on this earth. So, just like Moses was not able to enter the promised land, just like some of these men might have seen the promise of God soon coming, they will see it because God has promised in His Word. You know, as long as this persecution continued in the church, they remained relatively pure. But as persecution ceased, converts were added to the church who were less sincere and devoted, and opened the way for Satan to develop a foothold. God doesn't forgive or neglect his children. Justice will be served. But God also permits the wicked to prosper as well as the righteous, and will reveal their true character and enmity against him. Matthew 5, verse 10 through 12, if you look at that, it says, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you, say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." If you remember the story of the life and death bell earlier, have you ever heard the story about the frog and the pot? The boiling frog is a fable that described the frog being boiled slowly alive. The premise is that if the frog is soaked into boiling water, he can jump out. But if the frog is put in tepid water, which is then brought to a boil slowly, it will not perceive the danger and will be cooked to death. This series parallels the story of the corrupt church of Thyatira, written about in Revelation chapter 2, verses 18 to 29. It talks about the slow influence of heathenism in the church, instigated by the devil himself. How many of y'all remember reading those prophecy spotlights? I like them. But there's another interesting thing is how the Catholic Church wants to include Protestantism now instead of stamp it out like they did before. This ecumenical movement has lately noticed to focus on imitations, to focus on commonalities, to sweep away the differences in viewpoints. Interestingly, though, Protestantism has not been described as an individually based movement, but it's rather as a movement itself, which movements are not destroyed, especially prophetic ones. The Waldensians I'm going to speak about were able to lift up a dazzling light amid the superstition and ignorance of the Middle Ages, and they paid for it with their lives. Historians point to the heroes of the Protestant Reformation like Calvin, Luther, and Zwingli in the early 1500s. And after all, the Reformation and the Renaissance are what made the modern world possible. But what if this Reformation was actually started approximately 300 years earlier? Even before Martin Luther nailed his 95 theses to the Wittenberg door. This story started even centuries before the invention of the printing press. A group of people in Europe started shaking up the world by passing on the gospel story hand-to-hand and mouth-to-mouth. So who were these Waldensian believers? John references them in Revelation chapter 12 when speaking about the woman facing the dragon. The woman represents the true church, while the dragon represents Satan and his followers. So in 1175, a citizen of Lyon, France, named Peter Waldo, discovered that Christ's words contradicted everything he saw in the church around him. One Sunday in Lyon, he saw a friend drop dead right in front of him, and he wondered, what if that were me? What would happen to my soul? Peter then saw the Bible account, and he was told very quickly to seek holiness and salvation. But he kept looking, and he said, what is the surest way? So one scholar quoted Matthew 19, verse 21, which states, if you want to be perfect, go. Sell what you have, give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me. So what do you think Peter did? He liquidated his assets and he created a society called the Four of Lyon. He wanted to study the Bible for himself, so he hired two clerks to translate the gospel into his own local dialect. And soon, the Four of Lyon were preaching the simple gospel all over the south of France. These Waldensians, as they were soon to be called, were the first in all of Europe to obtain the translation of the Holy Scriptures. I know you're all familiar with the comparisons made between Jesus and the Pharisees and their roles as reformers or leaders in the Bible. to be fair, let me give you just a quick little synopsis for the Pharisees. They weren't there. They had to memorize the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, that were written by Moses, and they were also required to be well-read and knowledgeable about the other books as well. But the Pharisees believed that God accepts and blesses people based on their personal holiness. However, Jesus, he was an outsider, and he didn't have their pedigree, but he knew his Father, and he knew that he loved people, and he didn't need their sacrifices to earn his favor or love. He understood that when we connect to God with our hearts, by knowing and experiencing his mercy for us, his mercy and power will transform us in our desires. One of the characteristics of the Pharisees in Jesus' day was their obsession with pointing out the sins of people and also their lack of holiness. The woman caught in the adultery and the prostitute who washed the feet of Jesus are just two examples of the Pharisees exposing the sins of people and desiring that they should be dealt with harshly. How did Jesus respond? He neither condemned them nor threatened them with God's wrath or punishment. Rather, he forgave both women and set them free from their accusers. His forgiveness empowered them to love God and leave their sins behind them. Jesus' challenge to them was designed to show that although the Pharisees were focused on teaching the laws and rules, they missed an even more important subject. They failed to pay attention to the reason and the person behind those rules and laws. When Jesus asked them to figure out what this means, he was quoting a passage of Scripture that they should have known. In Hosea 6, verse 6, which says, "For I desire mercy and not sacrifice, but the knowledge of God is the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings." If they had taken the time to study the passages that reveal God's heart and intentions toward man, they might have had a better grasp on why Jesus saw mercy and not punishment as a powerful tool in putting sinners away from God and away from sin. The last couple of sections here I want to go over is I want to contrast another couple of reformers during this period of time in the Middle Ages. And one was Peter Waldo, who you saw a picture of earlier, who liked Jesus, read the Word of God, and applied it to his own life. And the other was Pope Innocent III, who became focused on, like the Pharisees, on exposing people's sins and threatening them with punishment. Peter Waldo, in contrast, was a humble, virtuous, and charitable man. He wasn't interested in wealth or power, but rather sold what he had to follow Jesus and learn more about him. His discovery grew to a movement that enlightened much of Europe. But in contrast, Innocent III was quite the opposite. He was crowned Pope in January of 1198. He was 37 years old. He was a brilliant aristocrat with a fine legal mind and became one of the most powerful popes of all time. But not all bad, it was bad at first. Initially, he wanted to reform the church and began by attacking corruption. But as time began and his power grew, he became known more than for his good start. Here are eight other quick notable events for this pope. Number one, no other pope excommunicated as many monarchs. Number two, he was remembered for his crusades against the Albigenses. Number three, he was known for the disastrous fourth crusade that sent soldiers to take back Jerusalem and ended up slaughtering many Christians in Constantinople. Number four, he was remembered as the father of the Inquisition to root out heresy. Number five, he was focused on wanting kings and emperors to submit to him as Christ's vicar. Number six, his main goal was to extend the church's authority. He probably thought it was a good idea to make spiritual power supreme over temporal power kings, but in the end, the power part overwhelmed the spiritual part. In contrast, the Waldenses were too busy spreading the word of God than asserting their authority over kings. And the last few things Pope, he was number seven, he demanded obedience from kings and emperors. And the reason why he did it, he applied Jeremiah 1, verse 10 to himself. It says, "See, I have this day to take you over nations and over kingdoms, to root out and to pull down, to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant. And so he ended up with a blood fountain on his hands. Back then, people were ignorant about religious matters and had no access to the Bible. The Catholic Church focused on the ways that you can keep professing yourself, and by submitting to the Church's authority in all religious matters. Peter Waldo and the Reformers realized that the Bible wasn't about setting people out or how hard you can make it. Instead, it is about the blood of Jesus and what he has already done for us. Did you know that by spreading the gospel of Christ, we tap into another kind of power? This is the power that Christ gave us when he ascended to heaven. And many of you are familiar with Matthew 28, 19 and 20, the last chapter of Matthew, which is the Great Commission, where Jesus said, "Go and make disciples of all nations, teaching them to observe all things I have commanded you." That's the paraphrase version. The best way to absorb the gospel of Christ is to communicate it. Do we also have something we can communicate with our neighbors? In closing here, in 1177, Peter and his group were banished and driven into Spaceship Bell into the mouth of Italy. It became known as the Waldeck Camp. They held uphill that Jesus was our only mediator, and they taught that every believer has the right to learn from the Bible alone. These believers opposed prayers to the saints, rituals to get married, indulgences for those in purgatory. They also felt that people had the right to worship as their conscience dictated. The Waldenses didn't necessarily come to the Italian Alps to hide from persecution, but rather to find a base of operations to become their missionaries. These mouths that they retreated to girded their lowly bellies and were a constant witness to God's creative power and never failing in strength of his protective care. These mouths also provided a spiritual sense when they were pursued by their enemies. Here in the Rocky Mountain Peaks, where the people of all ages sought refuge from persecution and oppression, lived the Waldeck Camp. Here, the life of the gospel was kept lived for 1,000 years, maintaining the Christian faith. The Waldeck Camp feared that the Bible would eventually take it to them, and they tasked themselves to memorize as much as possible. They believed it was their duty to spread the gospel. They did this by stopping at those village here and a fireplace there and talking about what they had learned. They were doing what Paul was telling in 2 Timothy 4, verse 2, which says, "Preach the word, be ready in season and out of season." These principles of truth they valued above their homes, above their lands, above friends, kindred, and even life itself. Great Controversy, page 67, states that from earliest childhood, the Jews were instructed in the scriptures and taught to sacredly regard the claims of the law of God. We have the same responsibility today with our own children. Children were taught from youth to bear responsibilities, to be guided in the peace, and to understand the wisdom of silence. Their children receive their education from two basic places. One from their pastors and two from their parents. And the Bible was made their chief study. The pastors, who tended to the needs of their church and preached the gospel and visited the sick, etc., were sustained just like the Apostle Paul by free will offerings and also by running some trade or profession which, by necessary, to provide for their own support, but also provide secular calling for the advancement of their work. These ministers were trained as missionaries, and everyone was expected to enter the ministry, and who wanted to enter the ministry was first regarded or required to gain experience as an evangelist, and served 3 years in some mission field before taking charge of a church at home. The parents, on the other hand, as teachers for their children, were not blind to the importance of contact with the world. They would send their youth to institutions of learning in the cities of France or Italy, where they were exposed to temptation, who has witnessed vice or other heresies and deception from Satan's wily agents. But their education from childhood has been a big character to prepare them for all of this. According to the Great Controversy, page 73, to the Waterstones, the scriptures were not merely a record of God's dealings with men in the past or a revelation of responsibilities and duties to the present, but the scriptures were an unfolding of the perils and the glories of the future. They, like us, believed that in the end, they believed that the end of all things was not too far in the future. They saw this plan of salvation clearly and found hope and peace in trusting in Jesus. In my own sermon, I'd like to inspire you with some of the stories of Waterstone believers and their struggles against France, Rome, and Italy. And I also plan to contrast the views of Jesus and the church with that of their Roman counterparts. Do we have that same hope and peace in Jesus as the Waterstones do? Are we prepared to demonstrate our faith when the going gets rough? Are we prepared to stand firm even when our friends tell us, don't give up or don't be so fanatical? I'm inspired when I watch the youth of our church get up and stand in front of Jesus. I'm also inspired when I see the excitement of people putting forth their efforts to memorize Scripture. Folks, we don't have the liberty to sit back and relax or say, oh, I forgot, I don't have time. Somebody else will pick up that and take care of it for me. The time is now. Preparation is everything. The better prepared we are now, the easier it will be to take a chance for God when the conditions are much more dire.